In fact, before I proceed on to talk about the taxonomic revision of Smithia, genus Smithia, one of the legume, small legume genus, which has highest diversity in our country. And this genus in totality, I'll be taking, I'm just about to complete the taxonomic revision. And this is not a new sort of work that I am doing. I've seen first it was partly revised by my colleague, Dr. Arvind Pramanik, as part of his PhD. And subsequently, some people from the Kerala, one of the colleges in Kerala, they worked on the taxonomic revision of the genus Smithia from southern India. But this has not barred me from looking at this genus as a legume taxonomist, because this attracted me when I visited Kas Plateau, one of the beautiful paradise, I would say, paradise in Western Ghats, and declared as World Heritage Site. It's a flat land, and if you go in the month of September, and the most attractive thing that you see is Smithia. And it is called Mickey Mouse flower there, popularly. Nothing to do with the Mickey Mouse because of the red markings on the, of course, not this species. I'll show you the other plates. So I have taken up this revision of this genus, which is supposed to have only some 14 species in India, and three other species from Africa, and one other species from the Indochina or the Vietnam. Now this genus is a paleotropical genus characterized basically tubercular or pustular based frizzle hairs, medifix stipules. This is a unique character in the genus, medifix scarious stipules. Inflorescence mostly densely many flowered, very rarely one to two flowered, either axillary. But the flowers are all either scorpioid or sickened on the racemes. But sometimes towards the terminal parts of the plants, by reduction of the leaves, it becomes a panicle. The flowers are generally yellow and rarely purple and white. By, I don't know why this white appears both in yellow, dominantly yellow flowered one, and also dominantly blue flowered one. And the calyx is bilabiate. The vexillar or the upper lip distinctly obscurely bifid, and carinal or the lower lip is three lobed distinctly. And this character is shared with many other genera, in fact. But in combination, these are the various characters that you see. And another most important character is the diadelphous nature, where the bundles are 5+5 with uniform anthers. And the lamentous fruit, that is the jointed fruit or the segmented fruit, where the segments are folded like a concert in a wire. They are folded like a spring almost. And these one-seeded segments, either they are rounded or ovoid throughout the world, not only, wherever it occurs, they are either rounded or ovoid, they are reticulate to venous or verrucate, thinly margined and indehiscent. Sorry. Of course, seeds I need not have to describe, because the seeds are like typical leguminous seed. This genus Smithia is named after Sir James Edward Smith, who was the founder of the Linnaean Society and first president of the Linnaean Society. And this is based on, of course, there are several names under Smithia, namely in the genus, as a genus of plants, it is there in Clusiaceae, it is there in Convolvulaceae, and as a genus of animals, it is there in Nidaria, Vespidae, Lepidoptera, Turtleidae, and so many, Cylindrata, and Insecta, and also the Mollusca, all these genera. Of course, these are not based on the name of Sir Edward James, but this particular name is based on Sir Edward James, and it was described in 1789. This particular name is properly described in 1777, which belongs to Clusiaceae, but without a species he described, and subsequently this genus was reduced as Capoea, and now this Capoea is transferred to genus Clusia based on the molecular as well as the morphological studies. Now only this genus remains, and you can see that Melin's 1791, that is later homonym, which is now transferred to Convolvulaceae, has Humbertia madagascariensis, because the genus also grows in Madagascar. But I don't know how. This might be a mislabeling of plants, because you can easily make out, anybody on earth can make out the simple-leaved Convolvulaceae and a compound-leaved Smithia, which is in Leguminosae. Now, Smithia as a genus was first recognized by William Aiton in 1789, with one species, namely Smithia sensitiva, based on plants raised from seeds sent by Gerard Koenig, one of the disciples of Linnaeus, who came to India and lived in a place called Tranquibar, which is now called Tarangambadi. So this, from this place, the seeds were sent, and the seeds were raised in Royal Botanic Garden, Kew, and based on that, he described the genus Smithia with one species, the Smithia sensitiva, which is the type species. And this is the publication, and you can see here, seeds received in 1785 by sent by John Gerard Koenig. And this is the first, illustration of that species provided by him. Of course, there are very minute things that the seed, you can see here, the fruit, the lomentum, which is a spring-like thing, and which is enclosed in the calyx, which is the characteristic of Smithia. Now, Adanson described another genus called Dhammapana. And based on Zovanna Manelli of Reed's Artus Malabaricus, without describing any species under it, he adopted the Sanskrit name Dhammapana, given given on Reed's plate, which is a Sanskrit name. So morning, Dr. Gandhi was mentioning about the etymological things. And you can see, Dham means abode, home, house. Pana means meaning water, alluding to the plants growing in a marshy habitat or near water. So this is where the publication where Adanson described this Dhammapana. You can see, and referring to the plate of Artus Malabaricus, volume 9 and table 32, and giving certain characters, but he didn't bother to give the name of the species here.
But that is not referred in the interpretation of...
I will come to that. No, there is no interpretation. That was not, because there is no species described.
Okay. So.
I will come to that. I will tell you what it is like. So this is the original frontispiece of Artus Malabaricus, and this is the English version which was published by Professor Manilal. And this is the plate. This is the plant actually, which was called as Dhammapana, which is the Devanagari script you can see is printed in way back in 1678. And this plant, this is the description that was provided by Van Reed. And this is the translation of that. Now look at this. Because Sovanna Manelli is identified as Indigofera uniflora. I have worked on genus Indigofera for the entire Asia. And I found that this species never grows near water. It grows mainly in sandy areas and in dry places. And this has been misinterpreted, unfortunately. I didn't have a word with Professor Manilal, but now you can easily make out as to why. I will tell you as to why it is not. Because the leaves are pinnate here. Two to three pairs of leaves are there here. Whereas in Indigofera uniflora, they are almost palmate. And the flowers are all having a slender pedicel, wiry pedicel. And whereas here, you can see the flowers have very thick pedicel and short pedicel, which is the characteristic of one of the Smithias. And that Smithia is nothing but, again, Smithia sensitiva. And this was compared with, because this was misled by the name Maneli. See, that was Sona Maneli, and this was called Maneli, because Maneli is actually Indigofera aspletides, and therefore it was mistaken and misinterpreted as Indigofera uniflora, the other one. Now, coming to Melin in 1792, transferred Smithia to Petagnana with its species Petagnana sensitiva. He transferred Smithia to Petagnana, a genus, without assigning any reason, and he transferred that species here, and therefore it is now treated as a later homonym and nothing to do with the Smithia. But in Desvaux reversed this by retaining Smithia Aiton, stating that the genus has particular characteristic indicated in the figure. You see, this is the plate, and this one particular figure 12 is belonging to this Smithia, what he called as capitata, and Smithia capitata is totally a different species which is described subsequently by Dalzell. But this species name as Smithia capitata, but did not mention either Smithia sensitiva or Petagnana. And this capitata will not stand because it doesn't provide any description to this. Now, Kunz in 1891 inconsequentially advanced the nomenclatural starting point and stated that the oldest name of the genus is Dhammapana of Adans, and he transferred all the species he knew to it. But subsequently, when lot of discussion took place on this, and Smithia is now conserved against Smithia of Scopoli, which is an earlier homonym, and Dhammapana of Adans, because, and these two are rejected, because this without a species and this also without a species, they have been rejected. And now this is Smithia is the conserved name. Now under Smithia, now Smithia is assigned to, based on Matka phylogeny by Lavin et al., they have assigned this this to the tribe Dalbergiae. In fact, you can see this Dalbergiae clade, which is mentioned here, and subgenus, section, subtribe Eschinominae. Because traditionally, if you look at Bentham and Hooker, if you see genera plantarum, is traditionally put in the tribe Eschinominae. Now, tribe Eschinominae is subsumed into tribe Dalbergiae, and two clades have been formed here, the subgenus Oncopodium and subgenus Eschinominae. Under subgenus Eschinominae, to which the Smithia belongs, you can see Smithia subgenus Eschinominae, and so seven other genera, Cyclocarpa, Sommerlingia, Smithia, Kautskia, Himalaria, and Bryopsis. Now, before I go to the actual Smithias, this thing, I must mention that Bentham in 1854, in Mickle's Plantae Jingunanae, he created two sections, one as section Kautskia and another as U. Smithia. So all the species of Smithia today, what we have in our country or elsewhere in the world, they all belong to Smithia. But what he called as sections Kautskia, which was based on Endlicher's genus Kautskia with a single species called Kautskia africana, is now placed in a separate genus. This section has been transferred to separate genus for reasons which I will explain now. Now, a taxonomic revision of Smithia was carried out based on extensive and intensive field studies in India. I have not done any field study in Africa, but I have covered the entire genus based on the herbarium specimens, because there are limited species in Africa and Southeast Asia. Analysis of 1150 herbarium specimens, including all nomenclatural types of all binomials treated in my work. Specimen images in European herbaria, except BM and British Museum and Kew, which have been studied by personal visits. All other specimens are studied based on all the herbaria in India. All, I have not left even any university herbaria, even if they have 10 specimens. Like Bharti University has only 3 specimens of Smithia, but I have studied all of them. I visited all the herbaria. And then field studies most in most species rich areas of Smithia, and especially Western Ghats. I have been visiting Western Ghats for last 4 or 5 years, and a few areas in Northeast India and Western India, resulting in sampling 19 of the 25 species recognitions in this work. So practically, I have collected all species except one, Smithia grandis, which occurs in Darang district of Assam. I have tried several times. My colleagues also tried to help me, but we have not been able to locate. Now, in Smithia, there are about 92 binomials, of which, if you look at IPNI or Plants of the World Online, if you look at, there are tight 92 binomials, out of which, in Smithia, there are 20 which have been accepted as Smithia species, and 15 of them and two varieties have been reduced as synonyms of these 20 species. And the number of species transferred to Kartsky are 39, but 26 of them are accepted names, and 15 of them are synonyms again. And number of species transferred to Eskinomine are 6, and one of them is synonym. And number of species to Gisa species, these are all allied genera, one species. Humbertia, one species, and then Humularia, one species, and Zornia, one species, which is from Philippines, in fact. Number of species unresolved due to non-availability of type and very generalized description of the in the protologues has remained 7, because there are no specimens to identify this, nor the description is very generalized. We are unable to decide on what these species could be in that particular state. And there is an invalid name. That is only one invalid name which is there. And I said it is Smithia capitata. But Smithia capitata of Dalzell is an accepted name, because Smithia capitata of Melin had not given any description. Therefore, it has to be rejected. Now you look at this. How to distinguish between the two genera which have been, you see, predominantly earlier, all the species were put under Smithia. And as I said, Bentham divided the Smithia into two sections, Kartskia and Eusmithia. And in Smithia, these are the characters that you see, which are unique of Smithia, and are combination of these characters you can see. And in Kartskia, you can see here, stipules are midi-fixed, here basifixed. Some people call it a spurred stipules and non-spurred stipules. Leaflets opposite, always here. Now you can see leaflets are always alternate. And basal nerves, 2 to 4, and here only one nerve will be there. Only thing which is coming little close to Kartskia, one species of Smithia, which is there in our country, is Smithia purpurea, where it is one of the veins comes to almost margin, which is the characteristic of this. Perhaps that is the connecting link of that species. And inflorescence, of course, second racemes, and you can say distichous strobilous flowers, and wing petals. And I don't want to read out all these things. And you can, lastly, I want to mention that in Africa and Asia, this Smithia is in Africa, Asia, predominantly in India and Australia. Then, whereas Kartskia is only in tropical Africa, and there are 3 species in Madagascar. Now you can see the bracteoles, which are at the base of the calyx, they are erect in case of Kartskia, and the flowers are reflexed like this. And whereas in this case, they are never reflexed in case of Smithia. And you can see the stamens are in monodolphous condition, or single bundle. Gandhi said brothers in single bundle. And these are always in 2 bundles like this. And this you can make out now like a spring. The leaflet, the lomentum is like a spring almost, paste like a spring, cup of saucers on each other. And you can see there are different species here. I am not going to the details. And this is the distribution of Kartskia. It is in Madagascar and the rest of Africa. And this is the only distribution that we have in the world today. And if it comes to Kartskia, I will not go into the details, because I am not. But these are the so many names of Smithia which have been reduced under these Kartskia species. This is another list. And these are the four species of Kartskia which have been described by DeWitt and Duvignard. Duvignard is the first person in 1954 to revise this genus Kartskia, and Werdkot subsequently made a synopsis of the genus for the Flora Zambesiaca, and there he recognized three more species. I presume if you look at the species in even in Central National Herbarium, the collection, the duplicates that we have, and from Kew and from British Museum, there are large number of more species in this particular genus in the rest of Africa. Because Werdkot confined himself to Zambesiaceae area. If you take into consideration the Western Africa, there will be many more species that will be coming in this particular genus. Now the other species are the Eschinominae elaphogylan. You can see two Smithia species are under this, and Eschinominae pleura. These are the five species that to which the Smithia species have been transferred, and these are the other genera to which the Smithia species have been transferred. This genus has only three species, and we have two species in India, and Humularia velvisi, as I said, it has about 40 species in West, in East Africa, and Zornia diphylla, it is based on Bigeminata of Blanco. It has been only interpreted by Merrill, because there are no specimens of Blanco anywhere preserved. Now, this is the status of Smithias today, as it stands. You can see there are about 18 species, 20 species, and these are the new species that I have contemplated based on the collections that we have made. And you can see that the number five, Smithia abyssinica, is confined to only to Ethiopia, and Smithia finetti is confined to Vietnam, and Smithia elioti and its variety are confined to Uganda and three other countries in the eastern Africa. Erubescens is confined to South Africa. The rest of the species are all found only in India. Not rest of the species. I'll tell you. All these new species which are contemplated are based on the collections that are made in the field. And these are the unresolved species which I mentioned. And you can see from 1789 to 19, practically there is one variety which has not appeared here, which is there in the synonymy of Smithia vencobravi. There is one Smithia vencobravi of Gamble in 1919. But recently, only in 2018, one variety has been added, and I found that this is highly variable species, and I went to the type locality and collected not just from type locality, it has been collected from all over Kerala, and I found that it is a highly variable species, and that variety glabra which that have been described has been reduced as the variety of vencobravi. Oh, one announcement, it seems.
Assistance to all the participants up to the level of assistant professors. So tomorrow when you will be coming, please bring the Xerox copy of your I-card and the tickets, whether it is a flight ticket or train ticket. BSA is going to give you some partial travel assistance. So tomorrow when you are coming, please bring your I-card, Xerox, and your ticket Xerox. Maybe a flight ticket, maybe a train ticket. Thank you.
Thank you. Now you look at this. See, no character is unique to any particular species or of any of these genera. And a combination of characters. You can see the number of leaflets, 2 to 5 are more than 5 pairs, or the petiole length and indumentum, and inflorescence, solitary to two-flowered, second racemes or panicles, rarely capitate, and flower color, yellow, blue or purple, rarely white, calyx length, upper lobe longer, shorter, are equal, and fruit segments, you can see number of fruit segments are another important character, and the shape of the fruit segments and the surface of the fruit segments. I'll show you some pictures. You can make out easily how the fruit segment surfaces can be very useful in identifying the species. This is the distribution of global distribution of genus Smithia. You can see it is there. There are only three species in Africa, and there is only one species confined to Vietnam here, and most of the species are confined here, and I will show you the distribution. You can see this is the global distribution of the genus Smithia. You can make out that these Eliotii, Erubescens, Finetti and Abyssinica are the species from outside Africa. The rest are all from India. You can see we have about 21 species and 14 of them are endemic to our country. And only this South African species, you can make out that it is there. Erubescens is South African, and this Vietnam species is the Finetti, and Abyssinia species. And you can see Abyssinica is endemic to Ethiopia. Eliotti variety, Eliotti is Cameroon, Congo Republic, East Africa, Malawi, Mozambique, Nigeria, Zambia, and Madagascar. Whereas variety Sparsi trigosa, which was described in 1974 by Verdcourt, has Burundi and Congo Republic and Uganda. Whereas Erubescens is endemic to South Africa. Now, this is the distribution of Smithia in India. You can see that the maximum number of species are in Karnataka, Kerala, and Maharashtra, and Tamil Nadu. And all are Western Ghats states. Goa, we did not see many species, but definitely in Goa, we have about 4 species that have been collected. You can see the numbers are given here, but there are some states where there are no species at all. I feel that there are species, but we have not documented so far. So one is Haryana, Punjab, and Jammu Kashmir, and also Tripura and Mizoram. These are the 4 states where we have not documented so far. But I am 100% sure if these areas have been properly surveyed, we will get definitely common species, either Smithia sensitiva or Smithia conferta. These are the most widely distributed species. I am sure to find them. And you can see that Maharashtra has maximum number of species with 3 endemics. 3 endemics means they are confined only to Maharashtra and nowhere outside. But Maharashtra has a maximum number of endemics which shared with other states in Karnataka and Kerala. So, and Karnataka has 13 species with 2 species which are exclusively to Karnataka. And Kerala has 12 species with 1 species exclusively to Kerala. Now, if you go to any place in Maharashtra, any plateau, you should visit in month of September, and this is the scenery you see. Whole area will be painted like this. This is actually the Smithia hirsuta, and this photograph is from Kas Plateau, and these are the dissections that have been made, and this is actually a new species described by BSI people. Dr. Hemadri, and this species is also common in the plateaus. This is another species called Smithia purpurea, which is also quite common in certain parts. But it is confined to some pockets in the entire Western Ghats, right from Maharashtra down to Karnataka, down to Kerala, and further down to Tamil Nadu. And this is Smithia sensitiva, which is very common all along, and not only in India, even in Africa, and also in Southeast Asia, Australia, Japan. And you look at this. This is predominantly, the purpurea is predominantly yellow, blue flowered, with this pollinator guide markings as white. And you see the variant of that is purely white. This is common, you can see this commonly in particularly a place called Bhima Shankar in Maharashtra region. And this you can see, if you go to Kas Plateau, before the entrance of Kas Plateau, on the left-hand side, there are number of open areas. And in that area, you can see commonly this. But still, you can see there is a tinge of yellow in this. But these guide markings are again changing like anything, like almost like a bindi you can see. And so much variation is there in this particular species. And then this is these are also Smithia purpurea, which have variant colors, some pure blue to purple to light blue. You can see this is the kind of variation that you find in this is another interesting thing that I want to share. Nobody has described this particular small flowered one, and both are called Smithia purpurea. There is absolutely no difference between the two. But you can see that both of them grow, like obligatory species. They grow sympatrically in all the areas wherever it is growing. And again, this particular thing is confined to Durgawadi in Andhra, Maharashtra, and also Bhima Shankar. These are the areas it is confined to. But I tried to look at this, and I am unable to distinguish it as a species based on morphological characters, except for the size. Nothing else. Except for the size, there is no other difference between the two to distinguish between the two. But they sympatrically go. But I feel that now, based on molecular studies, I found that it is quite distinct. And now, this requires to be described as a new species. Now, this is another species. See, this occurs commonly in, particularly in Tamil Nadu and Kerala. And this has been described by Gamble as hirsuta. But the true hirsuta described by Dalzell is this, which is common in Maharashtra and Karnataka. But you can see how different they are looking here. They're totally different. So this species, again, I'm describing it as a new species. I'm not showing all of them. This is another species you can look at. This is the maximum number of species are allied to Smithia sensitiva, both which are from North India, particularly the Himalayan belt. And also, this particular species is confined, specimen is confined to, population confined to Agumbe in Karnataka.
Excuse me, sir, and please sum up.
I will sum up. And this is another new species that I am going to describe. And this is a collage of various species of Smithia that we have in our country. And you look at the seeds, the lomentum, seed segment surfaces. You can see the fruit segment surface. So very distinct. And they can be made into distinct sections, in fact, based on this particular surfaces. I have not showed all of them, all the 21 of them. I am only showing here about 11 of them, and I will leave it at that. So I thank CSIR for providing me funds as under the scientific emeritus position, and various herbaria where I have worked. And our BSI people have given me maximum support in terms of this, giving me the images and literature from Central National Herbarium particularly. And I thank you all for these things. Thank you. Anybody else? I know.
When I was working on my PhD thesis, I had a part of this video was also part of my
thesis.
That is about nearly 30 years back, I think. So, to some extent, I can remember all this genus and the species also. And again, the word that the sub said, Smithia Aiton, apparently there is a very unsettled one. Only one specimen is available in our herbarium. Based on that single specimen, nobody can surely say that it is still existing. Collection is there. That I can remember, but afterwards, if I go through the chapter, then again I can remember.
No, Smithia Oligantha. I had been to the type locality. Type locality is completely converted into buildings.
That is also another factor.
So, and there is no type specimen kept in the bladder herbarium.
That is there. And because bladder very old person who collected it, and there are so many changes are there, so Smithia is almost it is an annual type. So partly it can be possible to find out. Anyway, certainly you cannot say, because if we don't ecological features, if we don't study it, then we cannot, certainly you cannot say that it is extinct. But it's still uncertain.
It goes up to almost 3,000 feet from sea level. Significance, it's only used as a vegetable by people when it is not in flower.
Fruit segments can be really very useful. And I'm still analyzing because a few more parts are to be done. So this meadows you find in Maharashtra. And they say that when the cows eat this, they eat a lot of milk.
Sir, I request Dr. B.
Go there and speak, Alan. You can speak here. Sanjappa Saab is always good in research, and he was earlier called Legu Man. Now he's, maybe people say because I've seen his lecture 2-3 times, and extremely confident, and how he has used the morphology, simple morphology, and the kind of analysis he has presented here is extremely good and exemplary to people who are pursuing taxonomy as a in profession. And at the same time, I want to also remember that Kaulsa Morning said regarding the scanner use in recognizing the new species, novelties and all that, and the prospects of it in Botanical Survey or elsewhere in the country. But the point is, you know, the kind of analysis, the kind of comprehension that gets into original research will not happen in this scanner research or the research through molecular level. So taxonomy, classical taxonomy remains forever, and I thank Sanjappa Saab to give such a wonderful presentation on Smithia. Thank you.
Next speaker is my very old and young friend, Dr. A.K. Goel sir. He was former scientist and head Botanic Garden and Floriculture at National Botanical Research Institute, Lucknow. His specialization was plant taxonomy, conservation, ethnobotany, and medicinal plants. And he has been awarded SK Jain Medal in 1998, then V.V. Shivarajan Gold Medal of IAET in 2008. And in the same year, he has also received with J.W. Hirschberger Medal. So I request A.K. Goel sir to deliver his talk on Botanic Gardens, Centers for Ex-Situ Conservation of Germplasm Resources.
Gentlemen. So, from taxonomy, now I will be taking you to the conservation part about the ex-situ conservation in the botanical gardens. Some of my experiences, past experiences, I will be sharing with you in my presentation. You see, when we look at the botanical gardens, botany developed through gardens. You see, the botanical gardens, they are the significant instruments in the man's scientific and cultural development over the centuries. And you see the long history and the key role played by the botanical gardens during 16th and 17th century led towards the early development of botany and strong medical foundations world over. Several botanical gardens, they have played very important role in the economic development and commercial advancement in many parts of the world. Particularly the tropical botanical gardens were the major tools of colonial expansion in the 18th and 19th century. Today, the botanical gardens all over the world are transforming very rapidly and equipping multifariously for the R&D studies on ex-situ conservation of plants. You see, it's very common that the people they depend on the plants for food, medicine, and shelter. During past 5 to 6 decades, growing population, developmental activities, climate change, unprecedented wars, they have taken a serious toll of the habitat, of the forest resources, and the loss of plant diversity. As per the recent estimates, 350,000 species are there all over the world. More than 25% taxa, they are facing several serious threats. As you know, several taxa, they become endangered or extinct even before their economic potential could be evaluated for mankind. Particularly the developing nations, they are more prone to the serious threats. Just for the beginners, I have taken this slide. The biological diversity in the world as well as in India. We are sharing around 11% of the total biodiversity all over the world. As Director Dr. Ma was telling yesterday that now in India more than 20,000 species as per the recent estimates are there. When we look at the Indian scene, the Indian subcontinent has been bestowed with more than 20,000 species, one of the 12 mega diversity nations. Only with 2.5% of the land area, sharing 11% of the diversity mainly in four also global hot spots, the Western Ghats, Himalayas, Northeast India, and Andaman Nicobar Islands. Our country has been rated as 10th in the world and 4th in Asia among the more diverse, rich nations with the diverse plant resources. As a result, our plant resources, they increase many fold and also serve as an insurance policy, possessing tremendous potential for conservation and value addition. The major threats to the plant diversity have been habitat destruction. Dr. C.R. Babu was mentioning all this about the degradation, the over-collections for botanical studies, unsustainable agriculture and forestry practices, pollution, increasing urbanization, land use, spread of invasive and alien species, climate change. They are very, very some of the burning problems, leading threats to the plant diversity. When we look at the botanical gardens, you see, as per the recent estimates, there are around 1,900 botanical gardens world over. In such a scenario, responsibility of existing botanical gardens increases manifold, particularly in the developing countries, more particularly in Southeast Asian regions, including India, to ensure the survival of threatened plants and endemic plant species. In India, we have around 85 botanical gardens. Today, our additional secretary was also mentioning about assistance to the botanical garden. Ministry of Environment and Forests has been kind enough to provide assistance. And many botanical gardens attached with several organizations and universities have come forward to take advantage of this excellent scheme for undertaking ex-situ conservation projects, conservation strategies, and for the multiplication of threatened and endemic taxa. This is the tally of approximate botanical gardens world over. I will not go into the detail. It is self-explanatory, but you can just see in Asia around 300 botanical gardens are there. This is the oldest botanical garden. For the beginners, I will just show you. This is one of the world's oldest botanical garden, is still surviving in Italy, Padua, established in 1545. And now you see how they have transformed their conservatories to fight the challenge for the conservation studies, recent threats. Another oldest botanical garden in Southeast Asia is the Bogor Botanical Garden, established in 1817. This is oldest botanical garden in Southeast Asia. Particularly, they are conserving the dipterocarps in their conservatories, dipterocarp species. If I will look at some of the largest botanical gardens in our country, Acharya Jagdish Chandra Bose Botanical Garden, attached to Botanical Survey of India, Kolkata, in Havala. I was also there as a RA in ethnobiology project long back. Then Lalbagh Gardens, Bangalore. NBRI Botanical Garden, this is the oldest gate with the archaeological survey now. And this is the present gate. And then TVGRI. Besides that, some of the other important botanical gardens have been the Botanic Garden, Kolhapur University, and the Botanic Garden with Malabar Garden in Calicut University. And for the conservation of medicinal and aromatic plants, CIMAP has also developed the gardens at different centers. If we look at the purpose for the ex-situ conservation, we have to rescue the threatened plant species, propagate plant material for conservation biology. Since yesterday, this is very, very important for studying the conservation biology. A lot of emphasis has been there for this. Backup germplasm collection under various types of ex-situ facilities and programs. Reduce pressure from wild collections. Produce material for reintroduction. That's very, very important. Then preservation of taxa difficult to propagate. We have to look different intricacies in order to find this. We have to apply several techniques. Produce material for conservation, education, exchange and display in the botanical gardens. Now I will come to some of our activities for ex-situ conservation in our botanical garden. NBRI Botanical Garden is more than 200 years old, 221 years old. It was established in 1800 AD as a Nawab garden, Nawab of Awadh. So this garden now serves as a national facility and repository of diverse germ plant collection with a special focus on conservation, education, display, and research. The main features in our botanical garden have been plant introduction. We are having today more than exchange relations with more than 50 botanical gardens from within and outside the country, domestication of wild taxa, arboretum, conservatory, cacti and succulents, palm house, bonsai house, orchid house. These are the numbers of plant species and cultivars being conserved in them. Cycad house, this is the first house in India we have established in our plant house. Then a Jurassic gallery, particularly for the school children and college students. Fern house, a moss house, and garden for differently abled persons. Besides this, we are handling the ornamental crops, chrysanthemum, bougainvillea, canna, gladiolus, roses, and cerbera. And we are organizing every year two annual flower shows, chrysanthemum and coleus show in December, and rose and gladiolus show in January. So considering the rich plant diversity being available at CSIR-NBRI Botanical Garden, our institute has been designated as a national repository under the gazette notification by Government of India. It has been recognized as a lead garden to conserve the diversity of Upper Gangetic Plains. Protection of Plant Variety and Farmers Rights Authority and the Ministry of Agriculture, New Delhi, has recognized the Botanical Garden as a dust stress center for the ornamental crops like bougainvillea, canna, and gladiolus. Under the ex-situ conservation, we are maintaining the germplasm collection of around, say, 50 species like Erythrina recipinata and other species. I will come one by one. And some of the domestication of rare species like Butea superba, Rosa clinophylla, having only 5 petals. Then Raitia coccinea, Dischidia bengalensis from Sundarbans. And then besides this, we are having a very good collection. It was under a project funded by Ministry of Environment and Forests, this Nilambo species and their cultivars, and then Ural ferox. As I told you, this that we have exchange relations, we have been enriching the germplasm collection of Edinsonia, native to Madagascar, Edinsonia digitata, Edinsonia rubro stipa, and then Edinsonia za. One more species I was told now by my colleagues that Edinsonia madagascarensis have been introduced in the botanical garden. We have transplanted them at different locations, and when we are seeing their performances. Another species which has gone extinct from the nature, we surveyed, we visited the different herbaria, is the Isonendra villosa of the family Sapotaceae. Is endemic and rare from Andhra Pradesh, Kerala, and Tamil Nadu. So we are trying to multiply this through asexual meaning, because the seeds were not viable at all, and we could multiply it, and we have tried to exchange with different botanical gardens, particularly with BSI and other university botanical gardens. Another species, Indopeptidinia, this is very important species of Mimosaceae family, from Suhelva Wildlife Sanctuary. It is a signature species of the Suhelva Wildlife Sanctuary. It was collected from Siryanala and Rampur Range in Suhelva Wildlife. It is locally called as Gethi, and it is logged for the fodder purposes. And you have to collect the healthy seeds. For this, you have to keep a watch that this when the seeds get matured, immediately you have to visit the forest and collect the healthy seeds. Because the onset of rains is there. When even a single rain comes, then the seeds get infested and you will not get the viable seeds. Hardly the germination percentage will be 1. With the healthy seeds, we could germinate even 80 to 90% germination we could achieve. You can see some of the plants which we transplanted 7-8 years back. Now they have started flowering and fruiting. Another species, very important species, we took Electra chitrakutensis. It is a of the Orobanchaceae. It is a root parasite on Vitex nigando. It is locally called as Nirgundi or Nirgundakala. It is endemic to the Chitrakoot region, particularly in the hill slopes of Kalinjar, Khatri Pahal, Fatakshila, and Ludwara regions along the Dasan River. In Chitrakoot now, developmental activities are taking place. So now the habitat of this plant is under danger. And you see this species also collected extensively by local traditional healers for treatment of leprosy, leukoderma, and weakness. So habitat destruction is the main reason for this. These are the 4 main, and you see developmental activities, all the slopes are being disturbed. As a result, this species is under threatened. Another species which we took from the Shivalik Hills, the Sophra mollis, it flowers under the Lucknow conditions very profusely, but the fruit setting and seed setting has been very, very poor, 7 to 8%. Germination also, we could germinate 4 to 5% seeds. But we are trying our best to multiply. And we tried with the tissue culture also, but we could not get any success. Another species we have taken up, this is indigenous to the Punjab and Rajasthan area, Ephedra foliata, variety ciliata. And we could collect the seeds. And we are trying through the seeds to multiply it further. One more species, under the exchange program, we could get the seeds of Welwitschia mirabilis. This is very, very important, particularly for the students. We could get the seeds from. This was my first introduction when I went to the NBRI Botanical Garden in 1989 from NBG Claremont and Botanical Garden, Dhelum. Belvisia mirabilis. And we have put the labels for the students, bilingual labels, giving all the details about the plants of Belvisia or other plants which we are displaying in the cacti and succulent house. This is the seeds I took when Dr. Mao was in the Shillong circle, this Nepenthes khasiana. And from seeds we are trying to the germinate and see their the performance under Lucknow conditions in a glass house for their further performance and growth, etc. Another, now we, during my regime, I tried to renovate all our existing plant houses. Under that, we renovated our palm house and maintaining the germplasm collection of about 70 species. And this plant house, renovated plant house, was inaugurated by Dr. R.P. Sharma, the chairman of Research Council, in 2011. So under this also, we are Trachycarpus trichael, and then Pentikia cordapiana, and Phoenix rupicola, such type of rare species we are trying to conserve and further study their performance. This, as I was telling you about the cycad house, this we established in 2009. Okay. So these are all 12 species so far reported from India of cycas, and we are trying to conserve more than 10 species we have conserved. This is a very, very important species, Cycas bedome. It is in the mentioned in the appendix 1 of CITES. And this species is smuggled to the other countries. That is very, very important. One seedling, small seedling of this species is smuggled at the rate of, say, so rupee, $150 per seedling. So we are trying to multiply and just see the performance, seed germination studies. Another species from northeastern region, Cycas pectinata, and seed germination studies are also under progress. This is Cycas cercinalis. This study we did with the collaboration of Botanical Survey of India, Northern Circle region also, and in our botanical garden, with the help of that also, we tried to study this species. Then Cycas swamii, you can see more than 100 years old seedlings in Karnataka region, and we have collected the seeds and tried to germinate and further study. This is another species, Cycas spherica, from Eastern Ghat region. And we collected the seeds, and we are trying to germinate under various circumstances. This you can just see, Cycas oryxensis. Another very important species we are having in our garden, Microcycas calocoma. This is a national plant of Cuba. We have a female plant. We are trying to get the pollen from the male plants, so that we can, if we are successful, we can get the seeds. Some of the species we could germinate and we could multiply when we were having both the sexes, like in Zemia lodicei. We could get the viable seeds, lot of viable seeds, and we are now trying to multiply it and exchange with the other botanical gardens. Then we established the Jurassic Gallery for the benefit of students and teachers, displaying all gymnosperms, minus angiosperms, all the ferns and mosses. And this gallery was inaugurated in 2014, January, by the then Governor B.L. Joshiji. And a lot of students now, they visit this gallery. It was established by the side of the cycad house. Orchid house, we are having around, conserving around 50 species in this orchid house. Under the exchange program, Maharani, Queen of, Thailand, Mahachakri Shrindhon, they gave two species, Bohonia Shrindhoni, endemic to Thailand, and Magnolia Shrindhoni. She herself came and she transplanted these two species, and they are performing well. We display all these, our collections in different flower shows, our strength and for the benefit of students and the general public. And this is a program to conserve the double coconut in Singapore Botanical Garden. And in our IBG also, this plant has been artificially, I think, pollinated and by Dr. Hamid, and now the fruit is under development. This is the Royal Botanic Garden, one of the best garden. They have different programs for the collection, conservation of cycads and orchids and other plants. This is the Sussex seed bank. Very, very important. They are conserving more than 40,000 seeds in this seed bank. So these are some of the important technical manuals required for undertaking the conservation studies. So in conclusion, I will say that more botanical gardens, they should come forward for ex-situ conservation program. Networking multi-institutional research programs involving many botanical gardens and institutes should be initiated for mass multiplication and reintroduction studies of threatened plant species. Under the constraint, I will just like to say that availability of germplasm collection of threatened taxa, desired infrastructural facilities, trained human resource, record keeping, networking in the botanical gardens within and outside the country is very, very important. These are main constraints. What next? Powerful partnerships, digital access. Above all, we must influence public attitude towards plant resources for their conservation. And we have to involve the local persons also, those who are living in those, some of the around, in and around of the habitats. So now after my retirement, this Dr. K.J. Singh, now who is looking after all my conservation activities. And I would like to thank to the Forest Department, regional centers of BSI, and some of the University Botanic Gardens like Kolhapur and TBGRI to help in plant collection and sharing their germplasm material. And thanks to our director in CSIR-NBRI, as well as my all team members in the Botanical Garden, those in the end for their sustained efforts under the ex-situ conservation program. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. And now I also thank Dr. A. M.
Well, he is my senior. Of course, when he has followed research for that, he is my senior research fellow. Anyway, he has discussed about the Botanic Garden, and in the, all the slides, he has shown it as the Botanic Garden. But when he just delivered the lecture, he all the way, he is saying Botanical Garden. I just want to make a bit of correction. Botanic Garden and Botanical Garden is different. It just, you can see that music college and musical chair or musical college. You can guess the difference. If I say music college and musical college, is it synonymous? It is not. Because musical, if I go saying that musical chair, in that musical chair it is a game, your chair is also there, music is also there, visitors are there, participants are there, but it is not a music college. And even in music college, music is there, chair is there, students are there, teachers are there. So, but it is not a musical chair. So like that, Botanic Garden and Botanical Garden is different. Botanic Garden exclusively for scientific research work primarily.
I mean only that, Botanic Garden.
Botanical Garden is for amusement, refreshment, relaxation. You can see the Botanical Garden.
Yeah, this is botanical Garden.
Having a specific infrastructure, should have some specific infrastructure. There should have some herbarium. There should have one library and enormous scope of doing research work. But in Botanical Garden, it is not necessary to prepare any library or any herbarium like that. People will come and see the beauty of nature and they will pass away with amused sense. But in Botanic Garden, it is not necessary. So sometimes we have shown some of the sites where it is not at all arranged one. some disturbed habitat here as well. If we say that it is a botanic garden, the people will say it is not a botanic garden. People say it is a little bit wilderness. But it is for scientific purpose that habitat has to be maintained in that natural condition. Because it is ex-situ conservation is being done in botanic gardens. So ex-situ conservation almost is just like a one child is brought up in hostel, in boarding, not in his in father's residence. So it is an artificial one. But that natural habitat has to be provided, so beautification is not a matter there. So he has done very nice work and digital work, botanic garden he has done all the way. But when he is delivering the botanical garden all the way, he is saying, it is not synonymous, of course. That is the
yeah, yeah,
the
it is not synonymous. It is not synonymous. It is a botanic garden. Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you. Nice lecture.
I request Dr. Pramanik to please felicitate.
Botanic garden and the kind of plants you have nourished in your garden. The thing is, research is extremely very important component in botanic garden development. If you are introducing certain rare species, certain threatened species, certain endemic species, the possibility of looking at them in the garden and their development, their life cycle studies, their ecological studies will be very, very, you know, it will be made comfortable for researchers to go and watch every day from the initiation to the garden. So the research component should be emphasized in all the botanic gardens. I mean, apart from promoting people to visit, to encourage themselves in the research. So that component should be also emphasized in all the botanic gardens. Thank you very much. Any other things?
Thank you, Venu sir. Our last speaker is Professor Kashinath Bhattachraya sir. He is head Department of Botany, Shiksha Bhavan, Vishva Bharati Shantiniketan University. His area of research are palynology, pollen allergy, ecology, and biodiversity. He is fellow of West Bengal Academy of Science and Technology. He is fellow of Indian College of Allergy, Asthma, and Immunology. He is fellow of Indian Aerobiological Society and core member of INSUBIO, then core member of GeoTask. So Earth Observation Priorities for Human Health Aeroallergens SBA, which was sponsored by NASA. So he is going to talk on documentation of biodiversity through the pollen analysis.
Respected is palynology, and this subject is very important in the context of taxonomy because you know the present APG classification, that is eudicot concept. Eudicot is based on the three culprit, and in BSI, especially in Kolkata, Howrah, there was one unit of palynology long back. Dr. K. Mitra was there, and he was succeeded by Dr. Madhusudan Mandal. But I think that section is no more in BSI. Same thing has happened for NBRI, where the distinguished scientists like P.K. K. Nair was there, and he did a lot of works in the Indian context, and he put the Indian the palynology in the world scenario. And still that palynology section is no more in NBRI. But in world perspective, it is a very important. But what I have already mentioned, that is all the APG classification is mainly based on the palynology. But we are ignoring this subject. And for the students generally, I will say the pollen grains. Pollen grains means it's the male gametophyte, and very interesting to say that if you carry out the pollen research, it has some advantages, because pollen representing a generation, and you can collect the pure pollen grains, the pure research materials. No other materials in the world you can have the purity, 100% purity. So pollen is advantage is this. So you can collect the pure form. And pollen, that you know, the pollen, it is the two concentric walls are there. One is entine, one is exine. And this exine is again stratified. This is the clue for the classification. And this is the stratification. And so not only the palynology based on the morphology of pollen. Sometimes these are also giving you the clue, because this sort of pollen units are there, dyad, and these are all tetrad, pollinia, and polyad. So if you consider the diversity, you will get in different, these also represent the different families. So that means it is a Potamogetonaceae family. So you can easily identify a Potamogetonaceae family by having this. And this is your T-shaped tetrad. You will get this one in Aristolochiaceae. So only the unit will help you to identify in a family level. So this is your tetragonal tetrad. You will get in Typhaceae. Even if you see this one, the linear, you will get in one genus, there is Mimosa, in Mimosa pudica. And these are also present in different families. So that means pollen units also give you the clue. Then you have the polarity, so different orientation, you have the symmetry. So these are all the criteria for the classification of the different families or genus or species. This is the shape classes. So you can also measure the shapes of the pollen, size and also shape. Then you will get, these are the shapes. Then you will get the aperture, very important aspect, aperture. So Dr. Artman in 69, he just classified inter ornamentation pattern. So this is called NPC classification. So this is based on the number of the aperture, the position of the aperture, and the character of the aperture. So we'll get the different without aperture, and this is the spiral aperture. So these are the classification, so that the whole plant kingdom can be classified based on this NPC classifications. And also the ornamentation. These also give you the additional help for the classification of the different plants. So these are the different processes present on the wall, or sub ornamentations also are there. So these are the clue. So just I'm in a glance, I'm just giving you some example how the different pollen look. So this you see, this is Amaranthus pollen, and this is Clerodendrum, Peltophorum, Delonyx, Polygonum, is Malvaceae, Hypomia. That means one pollen grain can be distinguished from the other pollen grain. One family can be distinguished from other families. So within a family, so one genus can be distinguished from the other genus. Even one species, you can also identify the species level also. So based on the character of the aperture, based on the size of the pollen, based on the surface ornamentations. And this was Takhtajan, who in 1980 published one paper in Botanical Review, where he showed the evolution of the different pollen apertures. And he told that single aperture, it's called colpus, is the base of the evolution of all monocot, digos, or other groups. So from this, in one side you will get Janthuraceae, like in Poaceae, in different families of monopod. Just one place. No, okay. There you told that from this single aperture, a tricolpid, that three aperture develops. And these three aperture ultimately proliferate to keep the evolution of different groups. And if you see the concept of eudicot, which was actually initiated by the Taktajan. So now the concept of eudicot means, all eudicot means they have the three colpid pollen grains. Now from the eudicot, you will get the diversification of the different groups. Diversification. These your asteris groups, these your lamids groups like this. That means the concept of APG classification actually was started with the Taktajan. Now, I am giving you a few of the examples where pollen, that is palynology, can be useful to demarcate the family level and to give the evolution of the different groups. So one I'm given from the India, the famous palynologist Professor Sunimal Chanda, he just did a beautiful work with Nielsen and Blackmore, where they analyzed all the families of Alice Metalis. And where he showed that Butomaceae, Limnocaritaceae, and all other members of the Alice Metalis, they can be distinguished on the basis of different pollen characters. And Melchior's edition of the English system, they placed Alice Metalis at the beginning of the monocot classification. And they refuted. They refuted the Melchior system and they established that Alice Metalis showed the evolved character of the pollen. That means Alice Metalis should be placed not at the beginning, but at the mid portion of the classification. And now, if you see the APG classification, Alice Metalis is not placed at the beginning. They place at the mid portion. That means the palynological evidences supported the concept of APG classification. So one example I'm giving you. The second example like this. So a recent paper published in the Annals of the Missouri Botanical Garden, where this scientist, along with Stephen Blackmore, they published one paper, and they took 17 different characteristic features of pollen. That is unit of the pollen, whatever I told you, that unit, symmetry, surface ornamentation, aperture, nature of the aperture, size, everything. They took 7 different characteristic features of the pollen to decipher the position of the early group of angiosperms. And they took the 8 genetic characters along with this. And they you see here, they beautifully, on the basis of pollen character, they beautifully arrange the different families. And you can see that on the basis of pollen characters, there is Anna group came first. So after gymnosperm, that is among the angiosperm, Anna group was the most primitive, most the earliest members. Then other members also, they supported the existence of other members. And they also depicted that dilineal is a sister group of the superestates. And this, that they supported the classification of APG, where the APG classification, dilineal is placed as a sister group of the asterids, superestates. And on the basis of pollen collector, they also beautifully they showed that all the evidences, that is not only morphological, but if you only take pollen as a single character, you can also classify all the members of the angiosperm as per the APG classifications. So this is a very important paper, came in 2018. Now, another aspect, whatever I'm doing, that sometimes it is very difficult to give the diversity of the local flora, like the flora of the city, flora of the town, or flora of the suburb. But there is another tool. It is called aerobiology, air sampling. If you collect all the pollen grains, and if you make the pollen calendar, you can give, not in 100%, but in a more accurate way, you can predict the diversity of the flora of that particular area. Not just going through your field, just you place your sample in a particular area, you collect the pollen grains, and you just make the pollen calendar, and you can predict the different vegetation present in that area. So I'm just giving you a few examples that we have done. So these are the different plants in different month wise. So you can just predict this in different areas. Okay. So the next part is, so not only the basis of the pollen morphology, but the chemical constitute of the pollen, it also give you a very important clue for the identification or to make the biodiversity in a very precise way. Just like you, this will give you the genetic diversity of the different plants. That is whatever different genetic markers they use, but instead of using the marker, if you take the pollen grains, if you analyze the chemical constituent of the pollen, you can also predict the genetic diversity of the different organism. The system is that pollen grain is marked with the different genes. And even exine, that is sexine and intine, exine and intine, you can also demarcate sexine and intine on the basis of enzymes present in it. Esterase is present in the exine, acid phosphate is present in the intine. That is, these are the marker protein. These are the marker protein. Then, there is a question that it was evidence that within a pollen, regarding his, during his development, at least 35 to 40,000 mRNAs are synthesized. So within a pollen, during its development, 30 to 40,000 mRNAs are synthesized. That means 30,000 to 40,000 genes are expressed within a pollen. Now the question comes, whether these genes are only present in pollen or the same genes are also located in the vegetative cells. Now it has been established that about 80 to 90% genes are the housekeeping genes. Because these genes are also present in the vegetative cell. But 10 to 20% genes, means 10,000 to 20,000 genes, those are only expressed in the pollen grains. That means they are the pollen specific genes. So our ultimately purpose is to find out the particular genes which is present in the pollen, which can be used as the marker, that should be used as the marker to compare the different plant species based on the genes of the pollen. And if you see that what sorts of genes are present within pollen, that is, pollen expressed and pollen specific genes. So among these 10 to 20,000 genes, there are three categories of genes. One, genes that have sequence homology to wall degrading enzymes. Because the main purpose of the pollen is to just form a pollen tube. And just for the formation of that pollen tube, these genes are involved. Because their role is to form the pollen tube and which will help to help for fertilization. Second one, genes that have sequence homology to cytoskeleton protein, means the wall formation, that genes involves in wall formations. And third genes, the genes that have sequence homology to pollen allergens. These are the important thing. Many genes are there within the pollen, and that genes act as a human allergens. So our purpose, just this one. Thus, we will find the particular protein which causing the allergy to human being. We'll analyze that protein. We'll characterize that protein, and we'll survey that particular protein, whether that protein is present in other members or not. And on the basis of that particular protein, we can make the genetic diversity, we can arrange, or we can make the genetic diversity among the different species. This is our purpose. And you see, these wall degrading genes, mainly pectin lyase or polygalactonuses. These are the cytoskeleton protein, that these are the genes, either actin, alpha tubulin or beta tubulins. And these are the human allergens, and one and many of the, and some of these human allergens have been characterized. One is pectin lyase, one is profilins, like this. So our purpose is to characterize this allergenic protein and to compare this protein among the different species. So what we have done, you see, first one, suppose we collected from cycas, we have analyzed the different proteins. We have analyzed, and through immunoblot, we have totally 17 protein have been analyzed, and among these, one protein we have identified as the major allergen, 20.7 KDA protein. Similar way, from delonics, we have identified 32 KDA protein. Then from catharanthus, we identified 18 KDA. Then from lantana, 42 KDA. Then from Attica, 19 KDA. And for Peltophorum, this one is 28 KDA. Like this, Alstonia scholaris, we identified 29.9 KDA. So these are the different particular marker protein we have identified. Next, we have to characterize this protein to know what sorts of protein this particular plant they contains. So for that reason, we use the immunoscreening, the single proteome of the particular source pollen. Then you did the mass spectrophotometry. Why did it? Suppose just we are giving you some of the work we have done, like this five species, lantana, there is sunflower, coconut, and two fungal species. Yes, just 2 minutes. Then these are the different we made. Ultimately, we did the 2D electrophoresis, because in 1D, you will get the one spot. The one protein may contain the other proteins also, having the similar molecular weight. That's why we did the two-dimensional electrophoresis, and ultimately we got 6 allergenic proteins from lantana, 7 from helianthus, 7 from cocos, 15 from carbularia, 14 from this rhizopus. Then we did the mass spectrophotometry base to confirm their identifications. Then we did this bioinformatics study. Suppose this one, aspartic protease, we got it from rhizopus, one species. So this aspartic protease, one allergenic protein, one marker protein of rhizopus, we have characterized this from one species. Then through the gene bank, we have compared this with other members. The same protein is present in other members also. That is starting from animal to pollen, to angiosperm, to gymnosperm, or other groups. Now, we compare it. And we interestingly found, I'm just giving you one example, the aspartic protease, that whatever we have characterized that protein, now we find two conserved regions among all the materials on Earth, all the labs. Then we made this dendrogram. That is evolution dendrogram. Okay? So dendrogram, what do you see? These are the dendrogram of aspartic protease. The one protein we have characterized from rhizopus. Now we analyze through gene bank, what is the similarity between the different organisms of the same protein? You see, we are getting this animal. All the animals, they are in a single cluster. These are similarity. These are the fungus. All the fungus, they also show. And these two are the pollen. One is your Cryptomeria japonica. One is lupin. Blue lupin means lupinus. Paplilionoideae. That means we made this genetic diversity. Just we collected the pollen, that's protein from the pollen. We analyze the pollen, we purify the pollen, we characterize the pollen, we ultimately identify the particular gene or protein, that gene, and we compare that gene with the different members present. That gene is present in the other members through the gene bank. That's why we can able to distinguish or able to make the genetic diversity based on one protein among the different members. And lastly, last slide, that whatever we have done, that in lantana camera, we have identified one protein, it is tomatin-like protein, and we send our data to IUCIS, International Union for Immunological Society, because they are giving the nomenclature of the particular protein or gene. So we have sent it to the IUCIS system to give the nomenclature. So they have sent the nomenclature. So lantana camera, the gene is LANC1. The nomenclature pattern is like this. First three letters will come from the genus, and species letter will come as a small c. And one means this is first time reported. That is this protein was reported first time. That's why it came one. And if somebody, if they report the same protein for other source, so same the land C will come and this, it will be two like this. Then we could able to identify lantana, this gene from lantana, HEL1 gene from Helianthus, it is pectin lice, then vicinal-like protein from Coccus nucifera, and CARP from Carbularia, and Rhizopus 1, RH1 from Rhizopus oryzae. So this has, that means genetically we have identified this gene. Now we can compare with the other members so that we can make the genetic diversity among the different members. And we are very happy to mention you that all this research have been highly rated and all were published in the best journal of the biochemistry or molecular biology, is called JBC, having high impact factor. So all the work has been published in three in the JBC and one in the Journal of Proteome Research. And now we could able to make the genes of different organism, of different plants, that's based on the pollen research. Now we could able to make the genetic diversity among the different members. Thank you very much for your patience. I'm very much sorry because I have some problem in my throat.
B.
Yeah.
sites where honey is being collected. It is a huge quantity. Even from the state of Gujarat, it's 5 lakhs of kg annually.
Yes.
And from the natural sites are processing soil.
Yes.
So I would be interested in why. But do we have some study on the paleontology?
Yes, yes, yes.
And
yes,
especially
yes.
For melanoma and trigon, which are very small species, and whose honeybees from these is very costly because it is used in tetanus by tribals. In tetanus, unicorn child, when they cut the. So I would like to know because they are very small bees. If I know that this is the flora which is preferred by these bees, I can protect those sites and especially.
Yes, yes, yes,
so
that's true.
And secondly, can we extract the DNA? Can we help of biotechnologists rather than going into the morphology of pollen? Is that true?
So one thing, very interesting, very good question for honey, because the purity of honey can be checked simply. You put one drop of honey in under the microscope, you could be able to see the pollen grain, means it is pure. If pollen must be very huge quantities. If the pollen is very less or without, that means it is spurious honey. It's one example. So it is a very ideal technique by which you can make the, you can determine the purity of the honey. And what question he asked it, that is, in our country, like in Gujarat, whatever he told, I am just carrying out one project of WWF in Sundarbanani. So our purpose is to make the GI tag the honey. Because what is the, if you are sure that honey is produced from a particular Prosopis julifera, okay?
Do we have the complete list of the bee flora, especially for trigona and melanoma? Do we have the complete list of the plants on which the bees visit?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes,
that is. Yes.
They are very small bees. And they depend on very, very small flowers.
Trigona means stringless bee. That is stringless bee. Yeah.
Most
small flowers.
Do we have the complete list? If we have the complete list, we can explore those plants in the past year. That is my question.
Yes, sir. I have published a few papers on trigona and this different bees.
The flora may be different in your reason.
I cannot say, but our region, from Allahabad, I have published that paper long back. And yes, from Chhattisgarh also I have published a few papers. If you want, I can send you a paper.
Hello.
Okay, thank you. We are already behind the schedule. We have so many other presentations, oral presentations up to this. Kindly, if you have any query issue, you kindly discuss over the tea. And thank you very much, Professor.
I request Dr. Odio to felicitate Dr. Bhattacharya.
He will be served here in this hall. Outside.
They can do that, that's better.
We can save time.
Okay.